In this particular lecture, I'm going to talk about buying and selling chapter of variant. So be complete attentive throughout the lecture. I'm going to just start it. Okay, so the first concept in the buying and selling is about the gross demand. We'll understand what gross demand is, what net demand is, okay. Simply, a gross demand is the amount of good that the consumer actually ends up consuming. What is it? It's simply amount of good consumer end up consuming. However, net demand is basically the difference between what the consumer consumes. So since it's net, it means it reflects, it's the difference between the gross demand, what is actually consuming, and the endowment. Endowment is something that we assume throughout that each consumer is having certain endowment of the goods. So let X1, X2 be the gross demand. And let W1, W2 denote endowment of the two goods. So the net demand, therefore, for good 1 will be defined by X1 minus W1. So if it is positive, X1 minus W1 is positive, indicates that the gross demand is more than their endowment. So overall net demand is basically positive. However, for good 2, net demand can be defined as X2 minus W2. Net demand can be positive or negative. If it is positive, means you are demanding more than your endowment. And if net demand is negative, what does it mean? X1 is less than W1, which means endowment is more than the consumption. When you have excess of endowment of a good over your consumption, that extra amount that you have with you is actually supplied. Instead of being demanded, we say this particular person is a net supplier of this good. So now let me write the budget constraint in this case. It must be the case that when we are computing the budget constraint, the value of bundle of goods consumed equals the value of goods owned. Now if I write down the equation of value of goods that is owned, this valuation is like an individual is putting the endowment into the market and checking the value of their endowment. So let P1 and P2 denote the price of the two goods. P1 denote the price of first good. P2 is the denotation of price of the second good. So if the value of endowment I have to check, it is P1 times the amount of endowment, which is W1 plus P2, W2. This valuation is giving us total value of goods owned. Value of bundle of goods consumed will be given by price times the commodity. So X1, X2 be the bundle which we are consuming. So the value of the bundle consumed becomes P1, X1 plus P2, X2. So this becomes the equation of the budget constraint. Now if I take everything to the left side, I can say the net demand can be defined like this. So P1 times X1 minus W1 plus P2 times X2 minus W2 equals to 0. So if X1 minus W1 is positive, now this condition must be satisfied. In this analysis, we are assuming there is no saving. So whatever value of endowment that you have, you spend entire income on the purchase of the goods that we are discussing here, which is the X1 and X2. So entire income is spent on the two goods. And if I write the equation like this, what can I possibly infer? If X1 is more than W1, means you are net demander of good 1, because X1 is more than W1. then in that case for equation to satisfy, this must be negative because P1, P2 are positive number. So if this is positive, this must be negative. Means if you are net demander of good one, it must be the case that X2 is less than W2, which means that you should be net supplier of good 2. So this must be the case that your endowment is exceeding the consumption. So you should be net supplier of good 2 in that case. Now, we understand the budget line along with the indifference curve mapping. Now, suppose the income we have is P1 X1 plus P2 X2 equals to M. And M we have is the income, which is defined as P1 W1 plus P2 W2. Right? Now, once price is fixed, the value of endowment is also fixed. Can we say that if this is fixed, the value of endowment is also fixed? So, the entire valuation of the endowment gets fixed. So, which means that income is fixed. So, I can actually plot this budget constraint in a two good space, x1, x2, and say a given budget constraint with a negative slope being minus P1 by P2. Since my endowment is constant here, and I can have a downward sloping in budget line. So this point must also be clear, that endowment point W1, W2 will be some point on the budget line. Say W1, W2 is a point on the budget line somewhere here. Now this is the endowment of two goods that I am having. Okay, now let's impose indifference curve in this analysis. Suppose my indifference curves are going like this. Okay, suppose this is the point of optimum. My IC is tangent to the budget line at this point A. Now at this point, if I check how much is my consumption, how much is my endowment, so I get to know that this much is my endowment of good one. W1 is actually less than X1. However, W2 is greater than X2. So W2 is greater than X2. If this is the case, that means I am net supplier of good 2. And if this is the case, it means I am net demander of good 1. So that's how we can understand the analysis here. The budget constraint is being satisfied. If I am a net demander of good 1, then I ought to be net supplier of the other good. This is by the formation of the assumption of budget constraint that we are taking here. Alright, next I'll move on to discuss case of changing the endowment. Suppose we have another case when we change the endowment. We'll see how will the analysis change. Now, suppose initially we have W1, W2 as the endowment, and now my endowment itself changes to suppose W1 prime, W2 prime, and this could be higher or less than this particular endowment. We'll take both the cases. Initially, suppose in one of the case, we take this budget line X1, X2, where my endowment is here, W1, W2 is original endowment, which is here. Now, because the endowment suppose has increased, W1 prime, W2 prime suppose is having higher than endowment at this. So, I have another budget because my income will rise for every price level that I have. Income will rise, so my endowment suppose changes from here to here, W1 prime, W2 prime, one case. And in another case, initially suppose this is my endowment, W1, W2. Now say W1 prime, W2 prime is another endowment which is less than my initial endowment. So I move from here to here, where my new endowment is W1 prime, W2 prime. Alright. Now, let's just understand what this means. If the value of my endowment decrease here my value of endowment decrease from this bundle to this bundle. So if there is a decrease in value of endowment, then the set of opportunities for the consumer will definitely decline. So in the sense that the budget set will contract, and therefore the maximum that I would consume will be on my budget line here. However, in this case, if the endowment itself increases, the value of opportunities will also rise for the consumer. If this was would have been the maximum point of consumption for the consumer, if IC would have been tangent at this given point, now with this new endowment, I'm able to afford more bundles. Suppose I move from this point to this point, this is my new point of consumption. So definitely I'm better off in terms of the utility and in terms of the income. So in this case, consumer is definitely worse off when the value of the endowment rises just because of increase in the endowment of the good itself. I hope this concept is pretty much clear. Next, I will explain to you what happens if we have change in the prices. Now, so far we did not change the prices. Now, if we have change in the prices, how will the endowment change? Okay, so let's take this as my budget line initially, and this is the point of my endowment W1, W2. Now, my income being P1, W1 plus P2, W2 equals to M. If here endowment is not changing, this is still constant, but the price change, okay? Suppose price change to P1 prime, W1 plus P2, W2 equals to M. And it could be the case that prices increase or fall. So let's first take a case when P1 increase, so that P1 prime is greater than P1, alright? Now if it increase, first thing we understand is that an increase in price will lead to an increase in the slope of budget line. So my budget line slope will rise, but there is one important catch here. Here there is a point on my endowment which is on the budget line. So my new budget line, it necessarily has to pass through my endowment. Think why? Because it's a combination of the price and the endowment that I have a given level of my income. So if my price change, it necessarily will be passing through the endowment. Now if it is increasing, so that means my slope rises. So I move my new budget line through this particular endowment, and this becomes my new budget line. Say it denotes BL prime. Alright, now let's take a case in which initially a person was having indifference curve here. Okay, so this is my IC1. Now at this point, what do we say? This consumer was having endowment W1 and consumption X1. So definitely we can say that W1 was greater than W2, and we check here X2 is greater than W2. So he is net, W1 is greater than X1 and W2 is less than X2. So he is net supplier of good one, and he is net buyer of good two. Alright. So what can we possibly say here is that because I am net supplier of good one, so will an increase in price of the good, will my value of endowment rise or fall? Think. The supplier will gain definitely because P1 has increased. So he's going to gain more by supplying more of this particular good, so that his value of the endowment will also rise. And therefore, he will be better off. When I choose a point here on this IC, definitely his IC move from here IC1 to IC2. And we can see that on a new budget line, my IC is tangent on the new budget line at a point, say B, and it has increased from A to B, optimum point. And what else do we see here? That at B point, IC is strictly higher, which means that he's strictly better off at point B compared to at point A. And this has happened because of increase in the value of his endowment. And so an increase in price if it happens, a supplier will choose to remain a supplier. Will choose to remain a supplier. Remember this thing. Because he's strictly better off. Alright? Now we'll take another case. In which, suppose the price fall and initially he was a supplier, then what happens? Then another case in which initially he was a buyer of a particular good, and then what happens? Alright, so let me take first case when he's a buyer. So if he's a buyer initially, then I have to make sure that suppose my endowment is somewhere here, W1, W2, X1, X2. My indifference curve is tangent to budget line somewhere here, so that I can show that X1 consumption is greater than W1 endowment, and hence he is net buyer. He's net buyer of good 1. So given this is net buyer of good one, initially I can see at this particular point, as the price fall. So as the price fall means my slope of budget line will become more flatter. So I move from this budget line to another budget line whose slope is more flatter. If this was BL1, this is now BL2, budget line 2. At this lower price ratio, what can I say? As a buyer, will I be better off or worse off? Now the price of the good that I am consuming and I am borrowing as a borrower, I am definitely better off with the fall in its price, because it's more cheaper for me to borrow it now, and therefore my indifference curve, which was here, it can expand further. I can move to a point like this B, and I am strictly better off in terms of my utility. So to a buyer, if the price fall, definitely he is strictly better off with a fall in the price. So he should choose to remain a buyer. In case of a fall in price, a buyer should necessarily remain a borrower. Okay. Next, I'll explain to you the case when the price fall and he's initially a supplier. Then will he choose to remain a supplier or will he switch to being a buyer? Think about it. So see, the endowment is here, and this is X1, this is X2. And initially, he's here. So, in case I am taking this point, let me take a case when initially he is a buyer. Okay, here we are showing a case when he's a buyer initially. And the price suppose increase. Will he choose to remain a buyer or will he switch to being a supplier? Let's think about it. Now if the price increase, so that my budget constraint, it becomes more steeper because the price is increased, budget moves to this point from BL. So at this we will check, will he be better off or will he be worse off if he switch to being a supplier? So definitely if he remains a buyer, we can see definitely if he remains a buyer, he will be worse off. So he should not remain as a buyer for sure if the price increase, because he's for sure worse off in case of the price increase. Now if he switched to being a supplier, there are two cases. It depends on my indifference curve. So first case, it's possible my indifference curve, when I move from this point to a point to the left of my endowment, I can say that he will be a supplier at this point when I'm on a point toward the left of my endowment. So it's possible I move to a point like this so that I am strictly worse off by moving or switching from buyer to supplier. So I move from buyer to being supplier when the price increase, but at the same time I see that he is being strictly worse off. there can be another case when he can actually be better off when he switched from buyer to supplier and the price has increased. I hope this particular graph is clear. So another case when the buyer switched from buyer to supplier and still be better off is, see, this is my initial X1, X2 bundle. Okay, now I move to another budget line because of an increase in price, shifts my budget constraint to BL to BL prime. Alright, now it's possible if I switch from buyer to a supplier, that means I move to somewhere toward the left of my endowment in my new budget constraint. So it's possible that my new IC is somewhat like this and my initial IC is much more wider. Make sure the ICs don't intersect each other, and that's why I'm making it more wider, look more wider. So say this is my IC2 and IC1. IC2 is giving me strictly higher utility than IC1, which indicates that if I switch from buyer to supplier, I am strictly better off because I'm on a high level of utility. So both possibilities are there. If the price increase for a buyer, initially if he's a buyer, if he choose to remain a buyer, he's definitely worse off. If I move to this point on a budget, new budget constraint, if I move to the right of endowment, definitely I'm worse off. But if I choose a point to the left of my endowment, I can say that by switching from buyer to supplier, there are two possibilities. He can be better off, or as well as he can be worse off, depending on the curvature of my indifference curve. Similarly, we can show the case for a supplier. I will quickly do it. If a supplier for whom the price fall, if he choose to remain a supplier, he will definitely be worse off. And if he switch to being a buyer, he can be better off and or he can also be worse off. Let's see how. So if price fall for a supplier, suppose this is my endowment, this is my point of consumption. Okay, now if the price falls, so I move from this point to this budget line. This is my initial budget line, this is my new budget line. Now if the price falls, then if I choose to remain a supplier, so I move from this point to this point because here I am still supplying, W1 is exceeding my X1, so definitely as a supplier I am worse off, right? So I will not choose to remain a supplier. Let's see what happens if I choose to become a buyer. There are two cases here again. If I choose to become a buyer, that means I will choose a point to the right of my endowment because here my X1 would exceed the endowment point, and so I will choose to become a buyer. So if I move here, it's possible that, yeah, this is my new IC2. It's possible, first case here I can see that IC2 is strictly less than IC1. Utility at IC2 is strictly less than utility at IC1, which means that I'm strictly worse off in this case. If I move to being a buyer from being a supplier, I'm strictly worse off in this case. But I can have another case, another possibility, that if I switch from supplier to buyer, I can still be better off. So I'll just discuss the last case here. When I choose to switch from supplier to buyer as a result of decline in price, so we want to check, can there be a possibility that he's strictly better off? So let's see. So initially this is the endowment. Now see, this is my point of consumption, X1, X2 is this bundle. Now if the price fall and I move to another budget constraint, say like this, alright, I can find some other consumption bundle such that if I have an IC tangent at this point, I can actually find that my IC. See, this is IC2, this is IC1. My utility at IC2 is strictly greater than utility at IC1. So it's possible that if we switch from supplier to buyer, he can strictly be better off. We have seen it through indifference curve math, but just make sure that the two ICs are not intersecting at any point, which is like the important property of indifference curve. They should not intersect each other. So when I switch from supplier to buyer, I can find that even with a fall in price, he can be better off. Another case, he can be worse off. Both the possibilities are there. Alright, next I will just explain to you the offer curve. Since it's part of the course, I will explain this part. What is exactly an offer curve? So offer curve, basically certain properties of offer curve is that it will pass through the endowment point. At some point of endowment, it's possible that the endowment itself can be a consumption bundle. So offer curve is basically for a given individual at different prices, will he be a net supplier or will he be a net buyer? Or there could be some point at which he is not willing to trade with the other individual because he's just willing to consume his own endowment point. So definitely it will pass through the endowment point, and it's possible that the endowment point itself is a demanded bundle because at some point it's possible that consumer optimally will not choose to trade. So as consumer may decide to be a buyer of good one for some price, I'll just write down. So as consumer may decide to be buyer of good one for some price, because for some price it may be possible he wants to be a net buyer, for some price it may be possible he wants to be a net seller. We just discussed this analysis, so we're discussing offer curve after discussing that analysis. For some price and seller of good one for other price. So the offer curve will pass to the left and the right of the endowment point, because it's possible to the left of endowment point he's a net supplier, to the right of the endowment point he would be a net buyer. So an offer curve will move like this. So let's check how will it look like. So taking x1, x2 here, if I have a budget line downward sloping with slope minus p1 by p2, there is this point at which I have indifference curve. So offer curve property, what we discussed, first property is that we pass through the point of endowment. Let's take the same point as the point of endowment, okay? So another property is that it will pass through an endowment necessarily and the demanded bundle. It could be possible the endowment itself is a demanded bundle. And another property that it will be moving in this direction. It will be like to the left and to the right at the same time. So such a kind of curve will depict an offer curve. So here is all my possibility where he will be net supplier of good one, because endowment will be higher than my consumption of x1, and all these points at which my endowment is less than the consumption bundle, which means that he would be a net demander of good one. So offer curve therefore moves in this direction, both toward left and right of the endowment point. So just remember this point here. Next I will be discussing the Slutsky equation identity when we introduce the endowment bundle. So before that, I will quickly explain the Slutsky identity. This is part of the Slutsky chapter which we discussed in the last lecture. So very quickly, I'll just define Slutsky identity. We write that the price effect equals to the substitution effect and the income effect. So how is it the price effect is happening? It is the change in demand due to the change in price of X. Alright, suppose now we decompose the price effect into substitution and income effect in this particular formation. How can we write? It is the change in demand of good X due to the substitution effect. It is with respect to the change in price of good X plus the income effect. See, income effect we write denoted by change in X N for the denotation of the income effect upon change in price of good X. So what we see here is that, if you remember, we discussed in the Slutsky equation, if the price of a good falls, then ultimately the purchasing power of the consumer will rise, and hence, in order to decompose the total price effect into substitution and income effect, we take away the income of the consumer such that we make sure the consumer is as well off as before in terms of the consumption bundle that he could afford originally. So now how much income do we take away? It is exactly equal to the change in price times the consumption bundle, the new consumption bundle here. So if I replace here delta px, it becomes, this value becomes delta xn upon delta m by x. So I can write here times x in this analysis like this. Okay, now let me just rewrite this. Let's say delta xn is represented like this. It's negative of delta xm. So I'm just replacing the denotation here of the income effect, and I'm rewriting this equation. So this ultimate equation will become delta x by px equals to delta xs upon delta px minus delta xm times x upon delta m. So remember this equation. This will help us in understanding Slutsky equation revisited. So it is just that I have replaced this in this notation and put the equation like this. Alright, now let me quickly discuss when we introduce the endowment income effect here. So in this particular case, when we have endowment value in addition to it, definitely we have understood if the price fall, there is one substitution effect into the picture, right? In addition to it, there is ordinary income effect. Why? Because as the price fall, real income increase, and hence people will tend to consume more, increase more consumption of a normal good. Let's just take normal good to understand things in a simplified way. So if price fall, the real income rise, and as a result of which the demand rise, and hence this is part of actually the normal good. Now what in addition can I say when we have endowment into the place? If the price fall, it's possible that the value of my endowment fall. Now as the value of my endowment fall, definitely my decisions with respect to consumption of the good X will change, and as the value of endowment if falls, then definitely my consumption will also decline. So how to incorporate this analysis in the equation form? We will decompose the price effect now into substitution effect, ordinary income effect, and the endowment income effect. Now that we have introduced endowment effect, you should be able to better understand this concept now. Alright. So total effect as price effect equals to substitution effect plus ordinary income effect plus endowment income effect. So we have discussed so far the substitution and the ordinary income effect, total effect I define like this. Substitution like this. We just discussed the decomposition of price effect into substitution and ordinary income effect before this, plus endowment income effect. So endowment effect, how do we understand? Right here. So endowment effect can be written like this. It is the change in demand when income changes times, so as the income is changing, so my demand is changing, times change in income, it's not divided by, it's multiplied by this thing, times change in income as price changes. So endowment effect is my demand is changing because of my change in income, endowment income, and my income is changing, endowment income is changing because of the change in the price. How can we represent this endowment income effect? It is a change in demand with respect to change in income, and the change in income with respect to change in the price. Alright, now since I know this particular value is exactly the change in price times the endowment, because here my endowment is changing as a result of which my income is changing. My change in income can be written like this. It's price, change in price times the endowment. So I can replace this particular term like this. So it can be written as change in XM by change in M times endowment, right? So if I replace this term here, so endowment effect is simply can be written as delta XM by delta M times endowment W1. By rearranging this particular equation, what do we get? We get this equation can be written like this. W of the endowment minus X consumption times this completes the equation. It's called as Slutsky equation revisited, because we have incorporated the endowment income effect here in addition. Okay, lastly I will explain to you the same analysis through a graphical picture. Now graphically, if we want to explain this, how do we go about it? Suppose I make a graph. Okay. Assuming this was my initial level of endowment, this is my initial budget line. Now if the price of a good X, so PX1, if it falls, so initially I move from here to somewhere here, I extend the budget line further, alright. So if this was my initial point of consumption and I move to a point like this because of a fall in price, let's see, if we do not incorporate the endowment income effect, we just know we move from point A to point B, and this is my final effect. But now to decompose this effect, I introduce Slutsky decomposition, and I take away the income of the consumer such that he is able to afford his original bundle, as a result of which I say that he was consuming somewhere here. So point, say C, A to C is the substitution effect, and C to B becomes my income effect, ordinary income effect. Now we also have endowment income effect. So lately we just discussed how do we decompose, how do we change the budget line when we have endowment effect. So we know that as price has fallen, so my budget line has become more steeper. No, sorry, it becomes more flatter. So I have new budget line which passed through my endowment point. So I have a budget line which passed through my endowment point. And corresponding to this new budget line, I have another IC. And say this is my point D, at which I can say this is my new point of consumption. So ultimate endowment effect when I introduce. Okay, so this point from this bundle, point B to D, is my endowment income effect. Alright, so A to C is the substitution effect, C to B is the ordinary income effect, and then B to D is my endowment income effect. A to C is my substitution effect. Here, C to B would be my ordinary income effect, and B to D would be my endowment income effect. Next, I'm going to talk about the concept on labor supply. So, suppose C is the amount of consumption on certain goods this consumer wants to consume, and let W be the wage rate, let L be the amount of labor supplied. Alright, so let's construct this budget constraint. Budget constraint can be given like this. Given M denotes already income of the consumer. So budget constraint becomes price into C, which denotes the expenditure on the goods, C, which denotes total amount of consumption, times the price is the value of my consumption. It's equal to M income plus my labor income. Labor income is defined as W wage rate times the amount of labor that I have put. So this is my wage income plus money income equals to my expenditure. This defines my budget constraint. Now I move on to explain you. It says the value of what consumer consumes, so the value of consumption, it must be equal to my non-labor income. So let's denote M as non-labor income plus my labor income, Y for income. Alright, now let's just change the budget constraint a little bit by saying that given that L bar, assuming it, that it's the maximum amount of labor an individual can put, which is 24 hours in a day. So let me introduce this term W times L bar on both left hand side and the right hand side. So what do we get? The equation of budget constraint becomes PC plus W L bar equals to M plus W L bar plus W L. So if I take this to left hand side, what does it become? PC plus W bracket L bar minus L equals to M plus W L bar. So this becomes my new budget constraint line. It's just rearranging the same equations. Alright. Now what else can I say? If L is the amount of labor, L bar is the amount of total labor that I can put in a given day, which is a 24 hours. So the difference between 24 hours labor minus actual amount of labor that I have is the amount of leisure. See, I denote leisure by R. Okay. So first thing we can note here is that the amount of leisure is equals to L bar minus L. And at the same time, the maximum amount of leisure that I can put in an entire day, it's also equal to the maximum amount of work that I can have in my entire day. So R bar equals to L bar. So now rearranging this same equation, I can write this equation as this: PC plus W times L bar minus L is the amount of leisure. So I can write here W times R, so which is like an opportunity cost of the leisure. So this is equal to M plus W R bar, because R bar is also equal to the L bar. So I can have this as the new budget constraint equation. Now keeping this in mind, let's plot the graph corresponding to it. We want to understand how labor supply decisions are made by the people who are supplying the labor. Okay, now suppose on the x-axis I plot leisure, on the y-axis we have consumption of the good. Take a budget constraint line. If I plot here, we will have a budget constraint line with slope minus p by w. Alright, and m is a constant number, w r bar is a constant value, so this is therefore a constant downward sloping line. And suppose my endowment is somewhere here, this is my endowment point, endowment of consumption and endowment of R bar here, and say this is my IC which is touching this point, so this is my optimum point. Now what does this point denote? That the my endowment of leisure is more than my actual unit of leisure that I am consuming, and hence the difference is my amount of labor supply. So this is what it means from this particular graph. Now, we can also incorporate Slutsky equation into this analysis. How do we do that? So, a Slutsky version of it is, we can say how much change in leisure will happen with respect to change in wage rate. As the wage rate changes, there could be two impact on the leisure. First is the substitution effect, and another one is the income effect. What is the substitution effect? If the wage rate rise, will the leisure rise or fall? Definitely, as the wage rate rise, my labor supply will rise, and so we are going to substitute away from the leisure. So substitution effect will be negative. As the wage rise, my leisure will fall. Now in case of income effect, what will happen? So now as my wage rise, I am going to perceive as an increase in wage as my rising income. As my income is rising, it may be possible I may not be willing to enjoy, I may not actually be willing to, you know, work more and have more of income, because already my income has increased, existing income has increased, as a result of which I want to enjoy more leisure. So income effect is therefore positive, means as the wage rate is rising, my leisure is rising. So it is a positive income effect here. It could be possible that the positive income effect magnitude is larger than my negative substitution effect, as a result of which overall effect is that as a result of say increase in the wage rate, my leisure is ultimately rising and labor supply therefore is declining. It's one of the possibility, because the income effect here dominates the substitution effect. Now this is very much part of a theory that initially, usually what happens is as the wage rate starts to rise, substitution effect dominate, which means that initially my negative substitution effect dominate the positive income effect, as a result of which we are likely to see a case where wage rate rise will lead to an increase in labor supply. But over time, as wage rate keep on increasing, we are going to substitute away the labor for leisure, and as a result of which I'm going to increase more of my leisure, and then the income effect dominate the substitution effect. Let's understand this analysis through graphical picture. Okay, here I have leisure on the x-axis. On the y-axis we have consumption. Say this is my initial budget line and this is my point of endowment. Okay, and say my indifference curve is tangent at this point, and this is my point of consumption of leisure and of the goods. Now with a change in wage rate, suppose wage rate increase, so due to a change in the wage rate, my endowment income effect, when I incorporate, I increase the budget line, I shift the budget line, it will become more steeper because the wage rate has increased, right? And it becomes more steeper, so this becomes my new budget line. Yeah, my new budget line is going to pass through the endowment point. So this becomes my new budget line. At this new budget line, say my intersection point of IC and budget line is somewhere here. As a result of which, what can I see? Can I say at point A and B, comparing these two points, leisure is rather falling and my labor supply is rising because of increase in the wage rate. Now further, if my wage rate is starting to increase, it's possible I move to a point here on my IC, point C here. My tangency point C is toward right of point B, which indicate that it's possible my leisure, because of further increase in wage rate, has actually increased. So A to B, the impact is my labor supply increases, while B to C, my impact is that labor supply decrease and leisure will rise. So we can see leisure is plotted here in this direction. So initially my labor supply from A to B, we have found that at B point my labor has increased, leisure has fallen. But B to C further, if the wage rate increase keep on increasing, my leisure has also increased, and therefore the income effect dominates after a point. If I plot this in terms of labor and wage, we will find a backward bending labor supply curve. So here I plot labor, here I plot wages. Alright, now what we see, as the wage rate is rising, initially as the wage rate is rising, my labor supply is increasing, but after a point labor supply is decreasing. So initially as wage rate suppose is rising from this point to this point, my labor supply is increasing in this positive direction. But after a point, as the wage rate starts to increase, my labor supply is falling. So I show a backward bending labor supply curve. And this is precisely happening because here income effect is greater than substitution effect. And in this region, so my substitution effect is greater than income effect, and hence substitution effect leads me to a case where labor supply increase. And here, because of dominance of income effect over the substitution effect, what we find is that with the increase in the wage rate, labor supply is falling and leisure tends to rise. And this is the situation, we call it backward bending labor supply curve. Alright, I hope this concept is clear. Lastly, last part of this topic is on the difference between overtime wage and the ordinary wage increase. We'll understand what happens if overtime wage is given in terms of substitution and income effect, and what happens if the ordinary wage increase. Which of the two type of wages would be better? Ordinary or overtime? Alright? Suppose on x-axis I have leisure, on y-axis we have consumption. Okay, now given I have a downward sloping budget line, so this is my point of endowment, and if suppose the ordinary wage is increased, overall throughout the wages increase, then I know that my new budget line is going to pass through the endowment and it's going to be more steeper budget line. This is my new budget line. Alright, and initially if I was here in terms of my optimality, this is my point of optimum consumption, I move to a point say here. So what I find here is that I am on IC2 now. My utility has increased because of increase in the overtime wage rate. I am better off. If I was already working, then now if I increase the work, I am paid higher. Now if rather we have another case of overtime wage. Now I am working at point A, beyond it if I am offered overtime wage, right? So if I am offered a higher level of wages, then beyond this my wage budget line will become more steeper beyond point A, because up till here it's same, up till here there is no difference, but overtime wage is given beyond this bundle, because here my labor supply is rising in this direction, leisure is rising in this direction. So can you see, the on the x-axis I have plotted the leisure, so my labor will rise toward the origin. So if I am moving from A toward the left side, my labor is rather rising. So I have see we have plotted budget line, which is more steeper toward the left of point A because the overtime wage is offered. Now at this given budget line, if I find, I can find another IC, say I denote it by IC3. Now comparing the different IC, can I say that IC2 gives me highest utility, which means when I'm offered the ordinary wage gives me higher level of strictly preferred over the overtime wage, because when ordinary wage is offered, then consumer can actually make better decision in terms of leisure labor choice. However, just if overtime wage is offered, then he is better off than before, but not as better off as in case of ordinary wage when it is increased. So I'm at point C in that situation. I would have been much more better off if I was just offered a higher ordinary wage throughout. Okay, I hope this concept makes sense and it's absolutely clear. So here I complete the chapter on buying and selling. Next chapter I will start with intertemporal choices. So thank you all.